Hi everyone, my name is Shilla Saebi and I'm here co-presenting with my colleague Dave Grizzanti. We're going to talk to you today about open source metrics at Comcast. Full disclaimer, this is a work in progress. We just really are here to share with the community what progress we've made and to learn as well as see if we can gain some insight with the community. And before I begin, Dave is actually going to do a demo at the end of this, so I will give you the backstory of why we needed metrics. So we have a Comcast open source program office that launched back in 2017. We support over 7,000 developers and over 141 repos on github.com. We're a four-person team, and we just actually became a four-person team. We were a three-person team up until about 5 months ago. We have two program managers. One is focused on compliance, and she's here today, actually, to point you out. And we also have our leader, Lydia Ruff. Many of you may have worked with her or seen her present in the past. And myself, I focus on community. Our fourth colleague is a compliance engineer. She focuses on tools, and she is a software developer as well. So within the first year that we opened up, one of the things that we focused on was getting people to know that we exist. We're a large company that is a very large consumer of open source. We use open source to run the applications that face customers, as well as tons of internal tools. So our first order of operation was, let's find out where we're actually consuming open source. So we started collecting data and figuring out where on different pockets of the company we're consuming. We also had created an effort to start meeting with different engineering teams. So my colleague and I, we met with 1 to 2, sometimes even 3 to 4 engineering teams a week for several months to raise awareness and let folks know that we exist. We wanted people to know that, hey, there's a central location for open source. If you want to contribute to open source, see us. If you want to learn what we're doing with open source, see us. And also, how do we... We wanted to make sure folks are aware that we're around. After 1 year, we sat down and we planned our goals. And we wanted to figure out, after we've now made our name known and people know that we exist, we needed to figure out how we quantify the work. So our leader came to us during our goals session and said, hey, let's figure out how we want to tie, we're tying our open source work with the business. So we needed a way to measure what we were doing. We didn't even know where to really begin and how to do that. So it kind of started off with open source contributions. We had those numbers. We had other numbers, but we really just needed a way to get everything into one place and start measuring it with metrics. Project health metrics came up. We wanted to figure out which projects are thriving. If they are, we want to continue to cultivate them, we want to continue to push forward and build community around them. And we also wanted to figure out which projects were not doing so well, which projects may need some more attention. We wanted to figure out, are there projects that are on GitHub that don't actually have a community around them? Are there projects that don't really have any users? They might have been uploaded 5 or 6 years ago and they're just kind of there to die. We wanted to either figure out, do we want to remove those projects? Do we want to archive them? Or maybe we just need to give them some more attention. So during this meeting, we sat down and we started defining what metrics we needed. So, because we're a large consumer of open source, we also want to make sure that we're contributing back to the projects that we're consuming. So what projects are we contributing to? I know that we're a big Prometheus shop, Kubernetes, OpenStack, Apache. Are we actually contributing back to these projects? Or are we contributing to something completely different? Are people outside of Comcast contributing back to our open source projects? Or are these just Comcast contributors? Which developers are actively contributing to open source projects? We currently have patents. We have engineers that put in patents, and they get promotions, and they have a nice path for their engineering career. We also want to do the same for open source contributions. We want to make sure people are being rewarded for their open source contributions. We want to make sure that we're incentivizing and giving people props where they're due. And then which Comcast projects have an active community? Myself as an open source community manager, if I find that there are projects that are thriving in the community, I want to make sure that maintainers are they're going to conferences and sharing the message, and we're continuing to grow those communities. So it was time for us to cross collaborate. We got together in an unofficial kind of hackathon, and as I mentioned, we're a 4-person team. The Open Source Program Office, often we are borrowing and stealing resources, engineering resources especially. Dave Grizzanti, who will shortly come up and introduce himself, he works on a cousin team, and he's a software developer. Turns out that a lot of the software developers at Comcast love donuts. And so we not only did that, we got together, we got some donuts, and we got into a conference room and a whiteboard. And we wrote down some features that we're looking for, what kind of metrics we're looking for. And at full disclaimer, it was a mess. We had hundreds of things we're looking for. But Dave, luckily, he helped us, and he started working on this project roughly 6 months ago in his spare time. So without further ado, I will let him talk to you about what he's done so far, and he'll show you the demo as well.
Hello, everybody. So as Shilla said, my name is Dave Grizzanti. This clicker's going to work. There we go. So yeah, my traditional role at Comcast is software engineer. And as Shilla mentioned, I'm kind of a friend of this source practice team. I use a lot of open source. Traditionally, none of the projects I've worked on at Comcast, had been open source or no contributions for myself. So, because I was kind of looking to get more involved, metrics kind of piqued my interest. So, for for the beginning, after we talked about, I talked to Krista about this like on the train one day, like I said, off trip, like some ideas I had for collecting metrics, from GitHub and a few other places. So for a few weeks, I was kind of like noodling this around, and luckily, an opportunity came up called Lab. So just to talk about this for 2 seconds. Comcast has this thing that we do 3 times a year called Lab Week. They let us basically do whatever we want for as long as it has something impacting the business. So you can kind of go outside your team and work on something that's outside of your daily job, or if you have an idea, you can go out to work. So the best example that we always bring up is if we're using voice remote, Comcast, that was a lot of fun. So I took the week and kind of just played with a couple of the ideas I had, which I'm going to talk about in a second, but this kind of gave me a good opportunity to spend like a chunk of time outside of my daily job, playing with different things. So Sheila showed this slide earlier. I'm just going to put it back up there with the GitHub logo instead of the keyboard. But the general idea is all of the metrics that Sheila was talking about, we can get from GitHub. Because all of the Comcast projects were there, and almost all of the other projects that we may use as open source tools that are not primarily ours are also on GitHub. There's a few things on GitLab and a few other places that we talk about getting metrics from, but a large majority of those are not on GitHub. So if we start from the Comcast page on GitHub, as Sheila mentioned, we have a lot of projects. So that took the screenshot this morning, so 224. So that's a mix of source, like true source, a few private things we're still trying to clean up, and then forks, which are also trying to clean up now. So like, it's a lot of things to pay attention to if you're just like clicking on each one and trying to figure out what's going on. It's kind of driving this whole effort. And then secondly, there's a bunch of other projects that we get upstream contributions to that are not driven by Comcast. We also wanted to pay attention to these. These are just a few examples of things that we know engineers at Comcast have contributed to in the past that are important to us. So, Sheila, I'm going to do a demo. know, live demos are always a little touch and go, but I want to talk about the tools that we're using that is kind of driving those dashboards first. So this is kind of broken into three pieces, and this was kind of as my exploration, you know, kind of winded, what piqued my interest to get certain pieces of the stuff that we needed. We kind of went through that path on day. So the first thing is GitHub archives. So this is a, it's not really a tool, it's kind of just a site I can go to get all of the events that are published from GitHub for every project broken down into hourly JSON files that are, you know, tarred and JSON. And GitHub gives you 20 event types for each repo. So whenever anybody pushes something or creates a user or any of the activities that are on GitHub, you know, they publish an event. And this is basically categorizing them all and syncing into these daily files. So if you download one of them and, you know, uncompress it, you just get this just JSON blobs of everything that's going on. So my initial just taking these files and like looking at them to see what kind of data is in them, you know, what could we use? Because our initial thought was, I'd like to see what people on Comcast are contributing to, but we don't necessarily know who those people are. So what's in the archive is usually just like an email address, or sometimes that's you know, hashed because people don't, you know, for privacy reasons. So it shows the use email, so in case we have to use the username that they gave us. So initially that was kind of exploration. So then I stumbled on this project by CNCF called DevStats, which basically takes those archives, parses them for you, and then puts them in a Postgres database, and then kind of gives you some buildings upon the dashboards that you can use to visualize the data. This project does a ton of stuff. We're only using like a small fraction of it. I'll show that in a second, but the general idea is you give it or Comcast or a set of repositories in time range, it'll pull down the files, parse them, and then, you know, put them into the Postgres for you, and then you can do any kind of SQL magic you want to pull out the necessary data. So this is primarily giving us commits, pull requests, things that come out of those events. The other piece that we talked about initially in that collaboration session was traffic data. And this was just to see, you know, what kind of traction our projects are getting. So GitHub gives you this on this Insights tab, it gives you data 2 weeks back per project. And we wanted to keep it longer than 2 weeks, and we also want kind of a cumulative view of all the projects. So this was not really using a tool, this was like a side, like I wrote some scripts to pull the data and put it in the data box. And graph it on it as well. So this gives you primarily clones and visits, whether or not they're unique or not. You can also get a bunch of reference data, where are people coming from today, searching on Google, on GitHub, Twitter, things like that. And then lastly is a pretty small project that people stumbled across that gives you a bunch of just general metrics about GitHub project and exposes them as a Prometheus endpoint. And then we have a bunch of Prometheus instances already running, so you can just scrape that. And you don't have things that you may not necessarily care about storing historical data, like number of stars, number of forks, how big the project is, how many issues are there. It's more just like what's current right now as a given snapshot. So those are the three, those are kind of the three pieces, three different ways we're collecting data. So the way we're kind of putting that all together, the way that I've tried to automate it as much as possible, so you know, since Shilla, the deal that I have to look at every day is most of this is running in AWS and some set of language functions. So there's a CloudWatch event that goes up every day, pulls those insights, like we have insights for all of our stuff, and then stores it into a Flux database on these two insights. And then there's a second lambda, same thing runs every day. I took that DevStats project and containerized it, and it runs as a Fargate container, like it just launches it, runs, pulls up on the stats for the last day from all the Comcast repos, and puts it into an RDS table, which is Postgres. And then the last piece is that Prometheus GitHub Explorer that's running its Docker container somewhere, and that's just scraping metrics off GitHub and exposing them at that point. There's no like walkthrough stores there. And then the last piece is just sticking that all together with proof. Just mismatching the data however we want to see it from those three sources. So that's it from that perspective. I'm going to jump over to the demo unless anybody has any questions they want to interrupt the program.
How do you differentiate where people are coming from? Comcast, not Comcast.
Okay, so that I'll show that. The basic answer is we ask them. We know the people that you're reading, and we ask them for their username. Because
right.
Unfortunately, like if you look at that those JSON file, like the things that are coming from the archives, you don't actually get the main part of the email. You just said that Comcast.com. So we don't actually know who the people are unless we know their username.
They changed that recently.
Oh, they did?
They made it worse.
So yeah, I think this is big enough. You know? Okay. So this is one dashboard that we built with a mix of the DevSense data and the GitHub exporter. So it gives you a project view at the top. So this is like what you pick from all of our projects and search them. There's a lot of things here. I've been using Trickster mostly because we're trying to promote it, and also it's a good example because it's new. So in the last 90 days, you can see here's all of our visitors over the course of time. Here's the commit events over that time, PR events, and then clones. And then to answer your question, here's what we did with breaking down the offer. So this is the GitHub username and a list. And here's the number of commits. This is really a number of PRs, not commits. Just as the way that the archives are storing that data, it's easier to see who the pull request author is and who the commit author is. And then we added this column that just says internal. And if it's true, that means it's a Comcast person. If it's false, then it's not. So we just have like a data source that's like these are the Comcast usernames. I wish there was a better way, but unfortunately, there's not. And there's some other compliance stuff that Chris and I have been working on. We try to keep track of that better. But like for this example, James Ranson is the primary author on Trickster. I think Julius is the Prometheus creator. So you can see like there's a lot of contributors outside of the company. Mostly just the primary contributor and a bunch of external people. You like pull up other projects. Similarly, like this project has a lot of visitors, but it hasn't had any commits. And as opposed to an external. So like, this Comcast OSS is probably an internal person who don't have the username. So jumping over to one other dashboard real quick. One of the other things we talked about was keeping track of like top contributors in the last year, internal or external. So this is similar data, like these are all internal people. Like, how many people have contributed a lot? So, like, Shilla's here, here's Krista, James. So, like, this is any PR that they've made, so any of our repos, or any repo, or any data that we're collecting right now. But that's holding to the Comcast side, so this still needs a little bit more work. And then, top external people on our projects, and projects that have recently contributed to. That kind of thing. And the last thing is the traffic data, but shown. For all of our projects. So this way you can see it like just a stack graph, like what kind of traffic are we getting across things. And the one interesting thing we learned from this is that there's a couple projects that are being cloned like a ton of times a day that are not getting a lot of contributions. So somebody's pulling one using the term cloud most likely. So that was interesting for us to learn. And there's just us preferred data. But I think I know we're out of time, but I want to pause and do really
one minute. Minutes.
Sorry?
1 minute.
Okay.
So that's perfect.
So does Comcast sort of require people to use their Comcast email? You'd like them to use their policy about that?
I think it's kind of a new thing. So we actually, like Comcast uses GitHub internally, but we use the hosted version of GitHub Enterprise. So your Comcast, your GitHub account doesn't have to be tied to your Comcast email. Because most people have GitHub accounts before this policy came along or before they started working at Comcast. So there isn't any official policy, I don't think, right?
Yeah, so as of right now, we don't have anything set in stone, but it's a work in progress. And we'd love to hear if you have a solution for that. But as of today, it's looking like we're allowing folks to use their personal GitHub account and tying the Comcast email to it as well.
I think it's funny because some people have two, some people have like a Comcast one, and it's so long. So.
Yeah.
Just curious about the licenses that your projects are based off of.
Are both their products?
Yeah, mostly Apache 2.0.
That's a choice that they can make, or is it an offer?
They're able to make a choice, but it's with guidance from our source advisory council and from our compliance program.
So do you guys have any plans to add other sets of data, for example, on the critics? This really measures the how active the project is, it's not necessarily say the truth out of the project.
Yeah, I think so. Krista and I, from a compliance perspective, it's kind of a mix of compliance and metrics. I think GitHub actually has a health score that you can get for projects. I don't think it measures anything about activity. It's more about like, does it have a license? Does it have code of conduct? Does it have a lead team? That's not really community help, it's more like project help. But yeah, I think one of the things I like to do with the data outside of just like looking at a dashboard is what projects that had the least contributions in the last month, so we can look at those projects that have the most. And I guess it depends on what you mean by health. Is it just commits or is it tweets or clones? Or like, I think it's a lot of definitions about what a healthy project is. So I think that's something we're still figuring out. I think we'll consider.
Yeah, and part of the reason why we're here today is to learn from you all and discuss.
What is the data you're currently collecting or planning to collect? Are you using them for career development or career guidance or anything?
Yes, that is the plan. So, for example, in order to move from one of our senior level engineering positions to the next, you have to be an active open source contributor. So this data will actually help us to give to managers and leaders as to who the top contributors
are. Can you just look at the best way you look at this?
I think there's definitely a distinction between pull requests, between the size of commits, but for now, we're really just rewarding anyone
who does. We're also looking at additional information such as, other forms of contribution, whether it's documentation, or being a member of an organization like Apache Foundation, being elected to be a member of the Apache Foundation, or sitting on the board of project. So trying to be a little more holistic. We're also giving engineers a chance inside the company to sit on the open source advisory council and learn how we make decisions on open source versus what is kept inside the company. So we're trying to make that criteria of being that distinguished engineer.
And Dave and I will be here all day, so please find us if you'd like to chat. We'd love to learn from you and share some stuff with you as well.
Good plug. You're doing four talks
today. Oh, yeah. I have a talk tomorrow on Trickster, one that Dave mentioned, and how we built a community around it at 1 a.m. The Open Source Summit at the Vancouver Convention Center.
Awesome.